All right, and of course, we come back from the ad break to the load screen, because there's no intro for this map. We are getting into Detox. I fucking love this map. I'm swearing a lot today. I should stop. But I really, really like this map. And I like this map for TVP especially. We'll talk more on that point in a moment. But spawning here on the bottom left side of the map, we get to see him fully and entirely here for game number one for the first time properly. It is the Pink Terran Beastie Cutie.
In the top right, as the red Protoss, he is Showtime. Your mouse control was on.
Yeah, I kind of slipped a bit, to be honest.
Oh, okay.
I feel like it's... Sometimes you have really nice mouse control, and the best way I can describe it is it feels like you're on velvet. But then there's other times where it feels like you're slipping and sliding on ice.
I hate the feel of velvet. My mom would sometimes, like throw, like, velvet, like, pillows at me. So that I would just be like...
Even if you don't like velvet, I feel like the traction it provides is really nice for things that need to be moved smoothly.
Like, the image of something, anything going on velvet actually makes me, like, teeth clench, you know? Like nails on a chalkboard.
I'm going to have to remember this. You're a very strange person, Zymro. Alright, so real quick, guys. We're going to go over the map. We're going to go over the layout. But again, because this is the Maturino Cup, and we've raised a ton of money already, got to give some quick screen region love to the top donors making this possible. So thank you so much. Again, Therminator, Saldus Dub, Lord Aesir, Mothricor, and Reims for being the top five people in today's prize pool donation accumulation. But Detox, for those who haven't seen it, it's kind of a unique map. We're really the only ones who keep using it in our tournaments. But BC's playing this a little bit strange. Now, I like Detox because it is a very, not defender's advantage, but attacker's advantage style map. You've got low ground versus high ground here in your main. You've got a very weird choke here towards your natural. And, of course, the third base has two entrances. Your fourths and fifths have backdoor entrances through your mineral patches. Everything here screams benefit to the attacker. And Beastie, I was going to give him some crap for not putting the depot on the barracks over here because he can do a quick wall off. But then I realized he's doing a bunch of barracks to match up his faster command center. So we see a lot of this, I think once upon a time in HOTS, it was like, okay, they're getting Marines strictly for the defense, right? But we've been seeing people like Euthermal and some others do these really weird pushes with those, like, eight Marines, six Marines to get out quick, and it catches Protoss off guard. They die to it in some instances. Yeah. And is he proxy on top of this?
I think he is. Maybe. Yeah. He doesn't have any gas, so he'd be proxying, like, more barracks, though. So this might
command center?
He just used a bunch of minerals. I think it just might be odd scouting. Like, I really don't know why that's up there. It's still not close to 400 minerals, but it looks like a hidden command center.
It looks like he wants to go for the hidden command center for sure. Maybe it's not something he's looking at right now, but we'll see. His scout, though, with the SCV did see adepts coming, and I guess he didn't know the degree to which this would be an assault. So bunker comes down, depots come down. He's walling this off.
Yeah. The problem with that Marine push is that Detox is actually surprisingly long map, so it took some time for Froton to get over her, actually. So that might have been the best maneuver. Plus, he did see the attack coming in. So that bunker actually reaches that pylon, not something that anyone else has tried before on Detox, still trying to get figured out as a map. That was a hidden base taken in the top position.
This is so clever. For this type of game, this is actually a great move.
I wonder. He really wants to put this pylon down. Jesus.
So,
it's not working.
Yeah, and the probe dies. Showtime.
That was really weird.
So I think he put that second pylon down because he wanted to buffer for the first one. You have everything shooting that other pylon that the second one completes and he gets an overcharge. This ends up not being worth it and he has to walk away. The kind of okay part about this, though, right? Like, the reasoning that I can say this is not so bad is he didn't over-dedicate to it. Now, for Beastie, I really like this hidden base. Every time someone does this, you hear me be the first person to be morose and say, this doesn't seem like a good idea. Except in this one time where you're sieged up, locked in, you would have pylons galore outside, you wouldn't be able to push out anytime soon. That's when a hidden base is actually fan-freaking-tastic.
I just wonder about the path of scouting for, like, a warp prism. I wonder if that is really the ideal hidden base to take, but... Typically, Detox is not going to these bases, so they're not going to scout it on accident with, like, a probe, for instance, but they might scout it with a warp prism, should Showtime go that direction. Detox, in general, I would definitely put, like, Zerg on top, and then Terran, and then Protoss on the bottom, as far as, like, who would prefer this map, and that was, like, you know, maybe, I don't know, up until we saw, actually, the Liberators come out, and with Liberators, this is actually an absolutely terrible map for Protoss. There is an abusive spot that cannot be reached by pylons or stalkers.
Well, we don't know that for sure. Because there was the two pylons that he couldn't get back there after Liberator was set up. We saw it was a night in, and it looked like that was the case. But the pylons were definitely not as close as they could have been to the edge.
I'm pretty sure. We'll see, like, well, we might see, that is. Well, no, actually, we know, because there's a Stargate. I think that this is something that I was talking about with Alba, that she confirmed that there actually is an abusive spot that you need to go Stargates. Like there is one on Dusk Towers, which she also brought up. Like, that's the one we found recently. Like, there's always been the Dusk Towers has been abusive for Liberators, but there was never that one spot that literally could not be reached. And then I forget who even what. It wasn't like a super like Gosu Korean or anything like that. It was just someone found the one pixel that works that you actually cannot reach.
It's like, you know what? That's the cool bit of like StarCraft 2 speedrunning, though, right? Where like speedrunners work frame by frame, StarCraft players work pixel by pixel.
Yeah, exactly. So, anyways, it would have only been a problem if Isuki had even gone for Liberators, which he didn't. He went for like that quick command center. And if Showtime had not gone for a Stargate, which he did, so.
Yeah, the Oracle not necessarily doing a lot right now, but it does keep BC on his toes. By the way,
yeah.
Oh, sorry, go on. You probably have a real important point to make.
I don't know about that. The Oracle goes down.
Oh, okay.
That's basically what I'm saying.
I was going to say, we've actually missed out on some subs, and I want to get caught up on them really quick. Yeah. Because we had a lot of 2-month resubarinos coming in, guys. So I'm going to just start from Referatu, so some of you may get a secondary shout out. I just want to make sure we cover all everybody. So SC2 Chimera, Harry Pun, Perfect Nugent, Onomats, Faisal 57, Dehymnizer. Dehumanizer, okay, 187, sorry, Kai Hosu, and then recently DBDO. Thank you guys so much for all resubbing and coming back. Because again, for those who don't know, we're on Subwatch 2016 as we see whether this sub count today falls to oblivion or only just a little bit.
We see.
Now, I want to go, before the fight begins, sorry, the income graph right now has been insane. Like, he's been dropping all his mules up here.
Yeah.
He was tentative to put SCVs in, but he decides to build them. Like, this base is just humming along.
Yeah, there's been no warp prism. The Phoenixes have been, you know, primarily on the bottom side of the map, and now they're making waves in the top and is natural for the reason. But they just has no scouting for a hidden base. In fact, BCQD already has a fourth base, technically. Like, his third is coming down on location now.
You were asking about Liberators. Looks like we're going to. You know, like, three starports.
Yeah.
So, kind of something funny that I was just thinking about when it comes to this. You know, Showtime may be unaccustomed to detox. We've talked about this. There's some players who have just never played this map because they always veto it in our tournaments. Beastie picking this base could have equally been good and bad. For the reasons of Showtime, either it's good because Showtime doesn't know the map, so it doesn't think to look around for it. On the other hand, though, it could have been bad if Showtime was like, oh, I don't actually know where fourths go, so I'm just going to check every base, you know? Like, there's a lot of ways this could have backfired on him, and this was a big gamble in more ways than normal, but this is paying off magnificently. And I think it's safe to say we're at this point where if the SCVs get pulled away and this base dies, it was still worth getting.
Yeah. What's so funny about hidden bases, though, besides, like, you know, you always talk about that it seems that people always lose when they get them, is that if the game is, like, passive enough, then sometimes it doesn't really matter. Like, they obviously had to like, still, like, a bigger bank because they just literally mined more. But if you're going to get up to 200 armies, then it's not going to be about who had a hidden base versus who didn't. It's just going to be about who has good control and, like, good fights.
The small dynamic to that would be you've got a safer fourth base to take because you took this ridiculously exposed fourth here, right? Like,
yeah. It's not that it's not going to affect it at all, but it is something that Showtime, like, he could actually win this game, go into the replay and be like, oh, we had a hidden base? Like, okay, that's weird. It didn't affect me at all. Or, like, the hidden base power is usually with some type of, like, you know, like, suddenly that two-base push, like, quote-unquote, it comes a minute later and it's so much more powerful than you expect, and you're like, what the hell happened? This didn't happen. Like, because he tried to go for a push, it was just ended up being drops. He didn't decide to do the drops because the Phoenixes were out, and they're both getting on to fourth bases. But Showtime probably thinks this is faster.
Well, we got the drop from Showtime coming in. I kind of like this. We'll see how much he gets away with. Starpants just reset for 2 months. And, of course, we got a brand new sub. Hype to Jokey 2000.
Woohoo!
I hope that's not the year you were born, or I feel very, very old right now.
Oh, he could be 15. 16. Oh, God.
Thank you so much for subscribing. Now, we do have Liberator Range on the way. And this is going to be interesting, because the game is kind of shaping up to be a quote-unquote normal game. Oh, the Phoenix are finally going to find this base, by the way. Oh, no, they're not! Are you for real? Okay, they saw it. They did see it.
Okay, so this isn't the Ling all over again. No, got it.
Oh, God, that Zergling from yesterday was so bad. So he'll kill all the SCVs, and the funny thing is he can't really fly the base away, so this kind of sucks for him, but Again, BC already got value more than enough out of this base, and the gas is mining off of it, tremendous. But now, the Phoenix have to turn around, and now there's a big fight coming at his doorstep, and hopefully Showtime's ready to fight. He does have an Adept Harass going down on the other side of the map, but BC, he doesn't really have anything on him to easily deal with this. He's going to set up a couple Liberators, hopefully cut out the damage. Meanwhile, over here, Colossus are in play. Liberator range has just finished. He's going to set up on the ramp in a pretty nice spot.
It's going to be a little careful. Like, this Phoenix count's actually surprisingly helpful for this. I mean, usually these things have died by now or just aren't in a big enough number, and oh, they clump. Oh, they do clump. So that's really nice of BCQD to recognize. Just leaving one or two Liberators on siege will help out not only against the Colossus, but potentially, or the Phoenix, but potentially against the Colossus as well as they clump up.
I'm trying to remember. There's a Terran player we cast recently who intentionally didn't siege up the Liberators and used them for air-to-air mode on the Colossus. It didn't go too poorly. With the account that BC has, that's kind of a viable option, I feel. But of course, the Phoenix should be the number one priority. They fly into the clutch of Marines and these Liberators.
Yeah, Colossus can deal with the ground army super quickly, and that's where they kind of become like the counter to Liberators. But it's still like these are ramps and chokes, and it's still going to be very questionable to go into Liberators with even this good of an army for Showtime. Now, BCQD is actually in a pretty, not okay spot for mining. He lost a lot of SCVs. He was down to like 32 and has just been rebuilding them. But think of it as he saved the command center, though, so he'll have a fifth, shall we say, easily.
I'm a little intrigued because we don't actually know. We haven't seen the situation. We'll hold the phone. Might not matter. Big surround here on top of the army. Colossus might take out the Marines, but you know what? These Liberators are going to kill everything on the ground and in the sky, and this is Showtime's army just getting obliterated.
Yeah. Good news is that BCQD's ground army also got obliterated, so they come out of it like not as bad as it could have been, but it's still pretty bad. That army supply almost double that for BCQD, and there's just no answer for the Liberators.
Liberator range. Gonna be really hard to deal with. One of the cool things was recently, I think it was Drogo, one of the Protoss players posted a video on how to deal with Liberators by focusing on more things like counterattacks and harassing. And unfortunately, the War Prism not being there and the Adepts dying in that main base, he doesn't have that option anymore, and Showtime is just going to, I feel, slowly get choked out. The leapfrog effect on the Liberators. He's even got Vikings in play. Disruptor gets sniped. There's just no way to really contest this. Even with the Stalkers trying to wrap around the backside, they blink into the Liberators and get obliterated. Oh my god.
Yeah, too many Liberators. This is definitely a very good map for Liberators. You know, we kind of talked about the early game, and I talked about Liberators sieging up that main base, but it's also just in general, there's ramps, there's chokes. No one bothered breaking down the rocks to either buy time or make the chokes a little wider, because most people don't really recognize those rocks down there. And just in general, it was a good choice for BCQD.
Yeah. Again, this is a map Showtime may have been very unfamiliar with as well. We don't know. There's always that advantage when you play in Base Trade TV Cups as often as you do. Like, BC, you know this map inside out. You've played a good chunk of games on it. GG does get called, and BC, he takes the first game in this best of three series.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, it's now 11 o'clock, so I've got to do the hourly update. What are we at for sub count? I'm scared to look. 1,236. So still definitely on the downward trend despite new sub hype, but that's okay. Again, guys, we're not complaining about this sub hype or the anti-sub hype or however you want to call it. It is just like that question of where does this end up at the end of the day?
Mm-hmm.
And oops, I just logged out of Twitter instead of making a new tweet because I'm really good at Twitter. So I'm...
Amazing.
All right. Copy that. Paste that.
I am a friend linked to this website. I am watching a bald eagle take care of its young right now in real time.
Like is it like a live cam thing?
Mm-hmm.
Dude, that was so popular, I feel like, 2 or 3 years ago.
Well, there's like, I don't know, I never like, had them up on my other camera, but there's like the kitten one, and then you could press buttons and it actually like make the toys go, and that was pretty cool. And there was the panda one that was also in DC, but I'm like, I live in DC, I can go see a panda whenever I want.
I'm half Japanese. I don't care about pandas.
Isn't that like a Chinese thing?
I actually don't know, thinking on it. Because I've seen them both associated with each.
I know, right? Like, but like China is like...
Like a Japanda bear. But China's where all the bamboo is, so I don't know. We are in the lobby for Dusk Towers and just waiting for BCQD to ready up. boom, let's hop into it. So, guys, we are continuing here with the Mascherino Cup. Make sure to type exclamation mark Mascherino chat. If you guys are enjoying the games, don't be shy. Please donate, because all the money from today is going to go directly to the players. We'll see you guys in a sec. All right, so before we get too far into this second game, people were, of course, asking, you know, what's one guy who keeps asking, so I just feel bad I'm going to answer his question. What's up with this? Is this a weekly? Is this a monthly? Like, what's the deal? Here's the thing, guys. Mascherino wants to experiment and see how this works. For them, again, they don't take any money from this, so they're not making any money off of this. They just want user interaction on their website. They want you guys to check it out. Mascherino is objectively a cool site and a good way for people to crowdfund for tournaments or show matches or what have you. The thing is, though, it's 2 weeks is what we've got locked in right now. After these first 2 weekends, so this Sunday, next Sunday, we'll reevaluate with them and see if it's worth their while, if it's worth them continuing to try and do this. Because again, they're trying to do all sorts of things in Overwatch and StarCraft 2, you name it, all over the place. But it does always seem like Base Trade TV seems to bring it home the best. We bring home the bacon. So we're hoping to convince these guys to keep doing more weeklies, because I think it's a really cool format, and I would definitely like to see more of this in the future. But spawning on the top right side of the map, he is up one game currently in his best of three. It's Beastie Cutie.
In the bottom left, as the red Protoss, he is Showtime.
And a very early probe scout to see what exactly is going on. Wasn't sure if this was going to be a little bit cheesy or not. Updates on the brackets, though, do show Mana advancing over Bam Bam. So the winner of this best of three does go on to fight against Liquid Mana, and we're probably going to follow to that series.
You got to say it like a baby.
Bam Bam.
Bam Bam. Bam.
Oh, wasn't that
Flintstones?
No, Flintstones. Flintstones. Yeah.
Bam, bam. Wasn't like the kid's name. Like,
I think that's literally his name. Yeah. Yeah, it was like Barney's kid or something. Yeah.
Yeah, that they adopted. He was like Savage. it's a good show.
Was he a predator?
Nope.
Is that why he was just savage?
Well, actually, like, humans are predators, so yeah, actually.
So I don't want to talk too much about Zootopia because it's spoilers and whatnot. It's still a new movie, but I will say that. I'm going to say this cryptically because I don't want to spoil it for people. The person they were looking for that went savage.
Yeah.
I remember thinking, like, since when in the fuck is this animal a predator? Like,
oh, I know what you're talking about. Yeah, that's one of those things that I learned, like, it's like one of those, like, interesting facts. Did you know that blank is a predator? But yeah, it is. It's savage, man. Like, you look those things up and what they eat, and there's some, like, really scary-ass pictures of those things eating, like whole, like, shellfish and whatever, shell crabs.
I love, by the way, there's going to be people in chat who are just going to start guessing. Like, this is, like, a Jeopardy question. They're just going to be starting, like...
Have you,
is it a jackal? A jackal? Oh, no. Is it a jackal?
I know you watched StarCraft 2 Jeopardy on Kings of the North.
Yeah, that was pretty fun with...
Because you were there.
I was cheering for Dave, man. Team Steadfast.
Yeah. I was cheering for Huck, man. The poor guy tried so hard. And then at the same time didn't try very much at all.
Okay, well, Reaper's still just kind of maneuvering around the ramp, map, not really able to get there for scouting. Beastie putting a bunker down. I like this. There's two interesting ways to do bunkers on this, by the way. Note to the third command center of Beastie: you put the bunker on the high ground and it defends against attacks pretty damn well, but you are going to get repairs and it would always be in range of everything. Reaper just died, sorry. Bottom half of the ramp, though, this is where, with the pylons having been shown in that last game, the fact that Showtime opened up this series trying to do the pylon mothership core attack, I would have assumed BC puts this on the low ground to prevent that from happening. The fact that he did go for the high ground actually surprises me a bit, I suppose.
Well, I mean, it was pushed back so easily, maybe he figured Showtime wouldn't dare try it again. I don't know. But the thing is that it's annoying, it's obnoxious to lose your supply depots, but if it's not early enough, if you're prepared enough, it's not going to end the game. So maybe the risk he's willing to take. Third CC is on the way. He only has these three production facilities. Well, you know, the 111. Well, it's done. Whatever. It's on the way to building SCVs and actually taking its location, all right? But the point is that he doesn't have a lot of defense. If Showtime was going for something that was aggressive, there actually would have been a lot of trouble for BCQ to hold against it, because he didn't go for a Cycling, went for a Widowmine drop. So these Widowmines would have had to been in good position to, like, stop the Warp Prism from even warping in. But luckily for BCQ, Showtime is going for his own third base, and he's actually getting some pretty nice scouting with his Observer, but there's not much to be done since he sees this third CC.
Yeah, Medivac with the Widowmines didn't really do a lot of damage last time, but that was against Spellsinger. We'll see how it does versus Showtime. Because I feel like even the best Protoss players, they've got that day, that one time the Widow Mines go off, and you're like, God damn it, I hope that wasn't on the stream. Mm-hmm. Oh, that was streams.
Yeah. Yep, yep, yep. These Widow Mines do get the chance to burrow, but the probes are instantly pulled, so only going to get one or two shots here.
A little bit scary because that medevac in range of both overcharges is going to go down. Very unfortunate. Meanwhile, Showtime's got an attack mounted on the other side of the map, and this is with a lot of stalkers, and they do have blink, but this is hardly enough to be an all-in, a small handful of them. They'll be able to drive back the third, I suppose, maybe pick off some of these freshly dropped mules. Oopsie poops. Mm. No, put those, return the minerals! No!
Oh, no!
That's like 90 minerals gone! No!
That was a nice pick off, all those mules. Really nice. And as I said, BCQD was only relying on those three production facilities for so long, and they just recently got up to two more barracks. So yeah. Upgrades are way, way far away. BCQD is going to be stuck on two bases for a while longer. And there goes the supply depots.
Someone might, I guess, like a Japanda bear?
A drop
animal.
Bear?
Drop. What's more deadly, a Japanda bear or a drop bear? What if you crossbred them and you had Japanda bears that dropped out of trees? Oh my god. That wouldn't be Australia.
Japanda bears,
that would be
hell. Are they as lazy as like Chinese pandas?
Yeah, so I'm gonna, by the way,
they
everyone
fall off and they're like, ugh.
I got some links on Twitter, people confirming that it's more of a China thing, and that's my bad. I don't know why. In my head I'd always thought like Japanda bear, like just it seemed more like it would be a Japan thing. I don't know.
Honestly, I don't really blame you, because I think there's been a lot of instances of just in general, people mixing the two and using the same pandas like signal for like not only Chinese food but also Japanese food. So you see that and you're like, oh yeah, pandas. Like those are just East Asian things.
I always there's always this one fact about panda bears I do know though, where it's like they're more closely related to like raccoons than bears, and I'm like, what? How does that work?
Is the red raccoon more closely related to bears?
Oh my
or
god, those are so cute.
I know, right?
Red pandas are like my favorite thing.
Yeah.
Just roll around in the snow all floofy. Just having a good old time. Okay, enough about that. Adept's going back towards the main, but again, it's two missile turrets. It's going to be really hard to sneak past this and actually get that warp prism in there. And even if he does, BC's still at home, so response isn't too far away. He's put that depot wall up to make sure the Adepts can't transfer to the main.
Yeah, this has been a... I mean, Showtime got that really nice pick off of the mules and got the third CC to lift, so it's gone a little bit better for Showtime, but this has been overall a pretty even game.
So you say that, and I've got no point to contest it, but I do like, you look at a map, and the map control, the base control, the expansions, I mean, for Protoss, normally you don't get to get away with this much. So to see it actually coming down pretty relaxed here on the fourth, not bad. But it's something where, give it another 2 minutes, BC starts to move out, you can split your opponent in half and then take down one of the bases because they don't respond correctly. Mm. These liberties, by the way, I think coincidental, but work out really nice if they catch that warp prism.
Yeah. They don't actually do that much damage to a single target, but there's two liberators this time, so they'll definitely tear it down. The army could try and maybe... No, not going to try.
Unload!
Rip! Yeah, I looked at the income advantage during that time, and Showtime has been winning it.
Yeah. Oh my goodness. Sweet. That stark peak of like 900 minerals.
Yeah.
That must be when the mules got picked off.
Yeah, exactly. That was the third CC going up. So, as I said, like Showtime got a little bit from the early mid game, but it's still like a situation where the army supply is really similar. You're going to have trouble regardless of if you think you have the answer or not against liberators. If they find a good position, then you're just going to get wrecked. But that's why Dust Towers is a good map. Not only do you get to three or four bases easily, which is what Showtime wanted, probably, you also have like a lot more wide open areas. There's a couple of abusive spots for liberators, of course, but nothing like Detox. Detox is all ramps and chokes.
Just all legs and curves.
All legs and all curves?
That's like, I feel like the map equivalent of that, where it's like, you know, oh, the map's all ramps and chokes, baby.
Mm. I mean, don't you usually say that she's all legs or she's all curves, like not both?
Maybe this is my ideal woman and you don't get to tell me who and what I'm into, all right?
She got them long legs, then she got the serious Muppet numbs.
She's got really long legs, but, you know, she broke them a lot when she was little, so they're kind of indented in weird spots, so they curve.
What is wrong with you?
What's wrong with her? Her legs are the ones that are messed up, not mine.
It's like, oh my, I'll do this after.
Triple overcharges. Wow. That actually ends up going a lot better for Showtime initially on the defense than I thought, but now Gateways are depowered to plenty. Both upgrades are stalled out with this attack. This ends up being a pretty nice drop out of Beastie. Oh, cannons. Son of a gun. Oh, this is kind of cool. He's going to try and feed back. Oh, space slammed right into oblivion.
There's so much energy on these medevacs, so that was a great choice. Unfortunately, won't get the last two.
Oh, Storm is done. Oh, so now BC's not only got to worry about he gets the feedback, that kind of sucks. Now he's got to worry about these actual storm drops, which are going to be... They're some of the most annoying things to deal with. By the way, we finally have an update from the Macherino guy. So apparently his internet's out, and that's why it took so long to get a reply. But they are working on getting some more codes made up for all you lovely people tuning in, so big love.
Woo-hoo!
Big attack out of Showtime, just going to march in the middle of the map. But BC's not looking to fight head-on. He was trying to sneak around, but I think he saw the Observer and realized the jig was up. Meanwhile, uh-oh! Double kill. Well, actually, it was more like a 9 kill, because, of course, one of those medevacs was full, so rip.
God, feedback's so brutal.
What would a 9 be? Because I know it's like, Septa is, like, what, 7? Hexa is 8? Or is that 6? Hexagon's 6, I think.
Hexagon isn't 6. God damn it.
I know, right? This is something I should know. I think a hexagon 6. So it's like Hexa, Septa, Deca's 10. What's 8 and 9?
Hold on. I'm Googling this. I got this.
Very important. Very important. While she does that, we do have an Onagon? Army fight. What? Did you just say a real word?
Pentagon, hexagon, heptagon, octagon, nonagon, decacon.
Nonagon?
No one cares about 9 points.
Nonagon? Sounds like a made-up word. It really does.
It does.
But it's also very fun to say.
Nonagon.
This is like, we have like a Dora the Explorer mode. Say it with me, guys. Nonagon.
Good job. We didn't hear you, but I'm sure you did it correctly.
All right. Lots of liberators on the front lines. Now, Showtime's actually setting up nicely behind this. We already have storms and some other things to keep the bio at bay. But behind this, Tempest Productions already picked up. He's putting down another Stargate. And while Tempests are not the best units for sitting and fighting, they are really good at just sitting back, sieging this up, and forcing the liberators back.
Right, right. Yeah, this game has gone to 5 bases for both players. A couple liberators being set by Blink Stock, which is always nice to see. A couple more, actually.
Good control to Showtime. I feel like we're watching a maybe it was just the map, because it feels like we're watching a completely different Showtime here in Game 2.
Yeah. Oh, that was bold. What the hell? Like, run right past the army with 3 medevacs.
He did make sure to drain their energy before doing so. Yeah. Thank goodness for that. Kind of sucks that they have no energy, though, because then they won't be too effective with the actual drop. But there's a Templar waiting, so definitely a necessity.
Yeah, now it's going to be useful for more Storm, but there's also Fusion Overcharge and Cannons. Like, the main is pretty well defended, even against 3 medevacs. A couple more Depths being warped in, too.
Oh. I just realized we didn't catch you on camera, I don't think, or I didn't notice. That was an EMP that drained the medevacs, too. That wasn't just them, like, healing up stimmed units. So that was really clever, actually.
Aww. Would have liked to have seen that.
Fantasy. Oh, Fantasy. Fantasy. Fantasy was doing that actually quite a bit when we saw him towards the end of Haunts. It was really cool to see.
Yeah. He's actually not even playing Brood War, which is surprising. Not yet, anyway. Most of these guys went back to Brood War pretty quickly.
I feel so conflicted about this because we've heard, like, you look at the Brood War numbers and you're like, wow, why is Brood War not, like, the main esport? It's got so many more viewers on Team Liquid, but... After talking with so many engineers and people who work at Twitch and analyze these numbers, like, it's pretty much confirmed that they're not necessarily fake, but they're definitely not representative of accurate numbers.
Even if they were, I feel like it's always been more about they're DJs is what they're called, but like they're not like StarCraft streamers. They're just like people that people know, like almost borderline celebrities. So it doesn't surprise me. But
yeah, we'll look for these EMPs coming in. Of course, they do manage to get a decent one. Feedback wars are interesting, by the way, because with Snipe having been removed, Ghosts don't have the auto win when it comes to fighting Templar anymore. Storms of Plenty, though, take out a lot of bio on that front line, still pushing forward. Showtime's army looks small, but make no mistake, it packs quite a punch. Disruptors and Tempest, not something easy to deal with.
Chat knew about the Nonagon, whatever.
Oh, well, you know what? Chat is a bunch of nerds who studied Roman history, so congratulations. We're in the Romans now. That's right, checkmate.
In extreme debt?
No, those are the Greeks.
Oh, damn.
Thank you, Rasunas, by the way, for the 2-month resub. Thor Steinsteiger as well. And anyone else we've missed on the resub train. Again, today and especially today, resubs are extra appreciated. High-capacity fuel tanks being researched. Funny upgrade, for those who don't know. It gives the medevacs basically 3 extra seconds on boost. Don't see this taken often. But it's not a terrible upgrade. It's just not something you can usually squeeze into your budget.
Yeah. But it's getting to that, like, split map type of position, and they're both on very good compositions, you know? There's not gonna be, well, there shouldn't be, unless someone really messes up the control, a situation where, like, oh my god, it's just an amazing fight, let's push and win. Because with the Tempest adding that range, and Storms adding the Splash, versus the EMPs and the Liberators, I mean, I guess a nuke could actually hit a lot of an army.
It was debatable to cancel this, because, of course, some of his own units were in range, but so were Showtimes. Drop here in the top left, though, does a lot of damage. We got a big drop going to the main, and this is the problem with Showtime's army. It's big, it's strong, but it's slow as hell. Storm in the main's pretty damn sexy. These overcharges are helping out a ton, but this bio army is still pushing through. Depowers gateways, cancels warp-ins. There's almost nothing
that's
here to defend this. The fifth base, sixth base, dies while this goes on. And Beastie breaks out in the most devastating ways. Showtime not killed by this move, but this was very important damage that Beastie needed to get done.
Yeah, killing that accessory base was pretty important, but unfortunately Showtime had one more storm that would have really been able to help to take care of the main army. Barely missed out on it, and so it's cleaning this up.
These are the types of moves in a TVP, by the way, that I can't help but respect. And it's not because I have Terran bias, but because you are choked in this position. You've got Tempest right up on your front lines. You've got EMPs not matching the Templar feedbacks. I mean, you're in a bad spot at home. Beastie uses this to expand, set up a planetary, get so much set up on the map, and now he's got some really good map control. Yeah, he had to give away a lot of army for it, but I think it was worth it.
You know, there is one thing that I think other races should be more jealous of when it comes to Terran. So they can be, you know, jealous of, like, you know, Reaper grenades and Liberator range, but what they should really be jealous of is all of the, like, miscellaneous etc. upgrades that we have, okay?
no one
else has this.
It's like, you're the rich kid who has all these toys that you don't always play with.
Yeah, exactly. So when we
while.
Yeah. Like, they need this, okay? We need to see, like, I don't even know what, like, stupid upgrade you give Protoss.
Does he get the Warp Prism? He's got four Templar, and he just picked off a Warp Prism with four full energy Templar inside of it. Great moves out of Beastie.
Could you give them, like, just, like, armor, I guess? Pylon armor. Increased pylon damage.
Well, I mean, they kind of have that already with the plasma shields upgrade, right?
I mean, that's true.
Attack on this side.
Damage. That would help. That would help late game.
I really like the way Showtime has put these cannons down. As we see, they've not stopped any of these attacks, but it did kind of buy them time.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm being slammed down for my Greek versus Roman? Or maybe that's you? I don't really care, guys.
Yeah, right?
I'd watch the History Channel to learn more, but now it's all about fucking, like, Hicks in the swamp hunting ducks. You know, there's no good things to learn on History Channel.
Yeah, there's nothing to learn now. Like, that's a real problem.
Like, what am I going to do? Read a textbook? I don't have $7,000 for a single page.
I mean, Rome still exists. Like, whatever, you guys.
Actually, there's the whole. I know it's a bit of a cliche thing, but the Seven Wonders of the World and all that. Like, I would love to see any of them before my lifetime comes to an end. Oh, this ghost, that's by the way. Cool to see that hold position, that hold fire. He wants to get up here and nuke this base.
Yeah. I love that they pocket their gun when they do that, too.
Yeah. This is the sickest distraction, by the way, because either he's going to be responding to these drops, or he's looking at the nuke, pulling away, and then doesn't respond to the drops. And I think he's responding to the drops, so this nuke is going to land. Zombie grub! All these probes are about to go down! Fan freaking tastic. Mancherino just subscribed to the channel too, by the way. Shout out Mancherino. Planetary trying to hold on the other side of the map. I mean, it's not, this nuke was good as it was, wasn't without consequences. And Beastie and Showtime, neither maxed, but neither without a bank. So I mean, they both have fight in them. EMPs land on most of these Tempests, by the way, and looks like they do pick off some of the Templar on the ground. Warp Prism not being focused, so all those Warpins finish up, advancing on the front line with these Liberators. Yes. This game looked like this was going to be Showtime, but Beastie now taking a very, despite his army supply disadvantage, nice lead.
Well, he's cornered, like, Showtime's cornered.
That turret hype, is that going to actually kill a Tempest? When does that ever happen?
Showtime has, like, that 30 armies by lead, but he was cornered,
oh my
and
God,
if
you
it's
know
all
what?
A Tempest, the Tempest can't be dealt with, there's no,
yeah, there's
no
Marines.
There.
There's no Marines, it's all Marauders.
But he still recalls. He didn't have to.
No.
He didn't realize.
The fact that this is all Marauders is hilarious, because if there was Marines in that army, he destroys any Tempest left over, but now he has to fall back. He has to let Showtime get away with everything that was left behind.
I think Showtime is actually the one that's in a little bit of trouble. Well, we did have 3 ACVs killed.
I think Beastie's actually in the worst spot now, because he didn't kill his
Tempest. He has such a bank, so he is trying to remax on a lot of Liberators and Marines, but that's where those storms really come in.
Yeah.
I think when BC did something to help.
Yeah, that concave, it looked like he was going to kill all the Tempest, but then when we so the second we realized there was no anti-air, that's when you're like, oh man, Showtime's got this. Let's not forget, it's game two, and it is looking like it might go to the ace match at this rate. We'll see. BC does have attacks going out on the left side of the map. Showtime advancing on the front lines, pushes back BC's fourth. BC, of course, has bases all over the bottom right side of the map, so losing these bases for the sake of income, not a problem. But losing production, that's where this game starts to fall apart. He's banking up everything he can in the main. He wants to take one great engagement to the best of his capabilities. Meanwhile, other side of the map still just trying to do as much damage as possible to Showtime, finding it really tough to do this.
Where's that new coming down? Oh, once again, at that fifth or fourth, whatever you want to call it. BCK does have a decent army supply, but unfortunately not like a very clear answer for the Tempest problem. Sure, he can send Marines underneath, but he's got to take care of the Storms first, the EMPs. Showtime does back off. That's going to give BCK a little more room to maneuver, maybe get a concave to help out. So Disruptors ought to be taken care of. Actually, that's probably even worse than the storms, because EMP could actually hit all of those. The Observer, I don't believe, is with the army right now, and that could be easy pickings, but the Disruptors, they'd have to be target fired manually.
So we got the Disruptors that are the problem for sure. I'm actually really curious about the Viking dynamic to this, though. Because let's say BC's Viking count is big enough to take this on. It's not. It's 100% not. But let's say it is. How does he use those afterwards? He's going to be garbage against everything that's left remaining, except for the Templar, maybe. Plenty of Marines, though. He's got anti-air capabilities. Those Storms. If he can get those EMPs, this isn't a problem. He's got a couple of Ghosts. Oh, man. He really needs to get those EMPs.
Yes,
lands them, nails them. No Storms available. Just the Disruptors now.
But the Disruptors. Oh, good splits. Look at the splits. He uses all his Disruptors at once. That was also the real problem
with
Showtime.
Is this BC
Cutie? Pulled the trigger too soon.
Or is this pull?
More Storms?
EMP lands on everything.
Yeah, the EMP also lands on the Tempest to help out, and the Stim, the overstim.
Oh
the
my god!
Is real.
But even with that overstim, it's not a problem. There's nothing to kill them.
Well, they're gonna just get outranged.
Look at the army supply.
That army supply, it was in favor about 20 when that started, and is now in favor of 50 for BC Cutie, who actually still has mining too. He's got the bottom right base. He's replenishing the other bases with orbitals and muling the gold base as well in the top left. This game is going for BC Cutie.
It's funny, too, because this, again, I already complimented both players. I really want to drive it home again, though. Both players so good to have this game even get to this point. Forget game one for a moment. It's the fact that we're here and now on Dust Towers, and BC for a while was choked in. BC for a while looked like he was going to die to Storms and Tempests, but has really done a great job bringing this back, and a lot of this through those drops. The nukes were cool. You know, that was flashy, and that was good because it killed a lot of probes, but ultimately it was a lot of these drops that did all that work from this game.
Missile turret alerting the bottom right base of those Tempests that are going to be able to eventually tear it down, but there's only six. Like, they aren't actually that scary in number. They're going to actually take down two bases because there's an orbital here, too. Taking on some SCVs, taking the missile turrets as they go along, too.
I wonder if you could fly the orbital away in time. I mean, Tempests do shoot so slow.
If you started right now, I think it'd be fine.
Right, well, gold base gets taken in the top center part of the map. This actually ends up working pretty well because we've talked about this. The less SCVs required, the better at this stage of the game. It's not that BC's lacking bases or minerals. It's the actual time to mine has been the problem.
He doesn't have any ghosts anymore, and he just scanned a hell of a lot of high temp.
That's so scary to see. But that is all of Showtime's gas bank, by the way. Like, Showtime actually has no more gas. So if these go down, that's it.
It's his only mining base. So BC Cutie could have easily gone to the other base and denied it, but the other base is already down. There's no other bases for Showtime that are mining.
This is getting kind of crazy, Zombie Rope.
Yeah, but I think BC Cutie has got it. He's starting to make ghosts again, even though there's an Observer and cannons protecting the High Templars.
If he recalls... Hang on. Yeah, if he recalls, the army would actually die to this.
We'll see. He's going to be very careful. He's about to actually just be seriously sandwiched between Marines and Vikings. The Ghosts actually do get the EMP. They tried to EMP the Mothership core. That was almost really cool.
If that had landed that fraction of a second sooner, that could have been a deny on that recall, too. That would have been really cool. Some debate in chat about what the prize pool is at for this. What the Matriano page says is what it is, and we are currently up to $235 for the prize pool of this entire tournament. Of course, big thank yous to Mothricor, Saldus Dub. Oh, Saldus Dub comes back big with another $30, by the way, bumping up to the number one donor spot. Krugerson donates $10 as well. So thank you guys so much for helping make this prize pool bigger and better. This is actually now bigger than the Alima League's prize pool, which might be why Olivia's got her feathers ruffled.
Oh, huh. And we do finally have a new coupon code. It is AMOVE. AMOVE.
Cool. AMOVE being the new coupon code. If you guys want to do it, we'll see how long it takes to use those up. Used all the other ones up so quickly. They were not prepared.
Mm-mm.
But, you know, we've been talking a big game for Beastie. The supply looks better for him. He's maxed out on upgrades. EMP's Liberator's broken as fuck, whatever you want to call it. But Showtime still has an army that can fight. That's what needs to be noted. Like, Templar could easily level out most of this supply. Tempest can pick away from far, far away. And, of course, Charge Lots are really good against bio. You know, we don't actually see it too often anymore, but Charge Lots have always been really good against bio.
There's a lot of micro capability for Showtime, but the real problem for now is that it's not a very fast army, even if it is microable, and the Nexus is going to be targeted probably eventually.
Currently, AMU has some problems with it.
Yes, I saw that.
So, just so everyone's aware, hearing this now on the stream, we just hyped it up seconds ago. Again, the people who are in charge of this don't have internet today. It's unfortunate, because, you know, power outages, whatever happened. So, they're working on it. Pardon the bugs. Now, he doesn't actually see these ghosts. Does he not have detection? The auto attacks are actually going to kill most of these Templars.
Right.
Snipes go down. Ooh.
So, I mentioned like a long time ago that there didn't seem to be an observer with the army. Now, he had an observer covering the cannons and where the High Templar were, so he brings that forward. But that was super, super dangerous. The Liberator's starting to take out the Tempest, actually, here. The Vikings, there they go. Now the Vikings are definitely going to take them out. They're getting awfully clumped up. There's the splits.
Yeah, the Surfers don't get the damage they wanted to. They could have had some magical hits, potentially, possibly. But this is the problem when you rely on splash damage. Like, sometimes it's more than enough, sometimes it's garbage. And this time, it has been some garbage. Vikings all died in the storm, except for one. There we go, gets finished off by the Tempest. But the Vikings no longer that important to the game. These ghosts with their auto attack and their high health pool may be better than the Marines in this situation. I don't know, but I do know that Showtime is on his last legs, fighting for his life here at the choke to his own third base. Colossus getting some pretty good shots, truth be told, but again, without a storm, without that little bit of extra damage on the bio, no way to deal with it. 20 supply and falling, GG gets called. BC is going to take a 2-0 over Showtime, which is damn impressive, and move on to fight against Mana next in the brackets.
Uh-huh, that is true.
Well, that's good stuff. Let's go over the match arena page before we go to the ad break, though. Let's zombie up sort of other things. Whoop. So, again, the coupon code's a little bit borked right now, guys. Apologies. We'll hopefully have that fixed sooner than later. But a quick look at things. Again, top five donors, Saldus Dub, Therminator, Lord Aesir, Mothricor, Krugerson, all get some special extra love. You can see all the people who've donated up until this point. Can I have a woot woot? Yes, you can, Wonderclass. Woot woot. But, yeah, so the match arena page here, we're up to $235. Truth be told, we're just going to be happy with more than $100. We set the goal for $400. That would be phenomenal. But point is, all the players are getting the money from this. There's no admin fee. There's no casting fee. There's no match arena fee. 100% of what you see on this page is going to go directly to the players today, guys. So if you're willing and wanting and you're enjoying these games, consider donating a dollar or two, because it can go a long way to helping these players get some more money.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we are going to go to a commercial break, as it's been a damn long time. It's been over an hour, actually, since we did our last ads. So, to quickly get shut up on the subs, or caught up on the subs, Private Wiggles, DeBurgum, Death Asleep. Thank you guys so much for resubbing for 2 months in a row. And we'll be back soon with more Match Arena matches. Mana versus Beastie Cutie explicitly when we return.